Thank you. Thank you for having me. I feel a bit short behind these things always. Maybe that's because I am short. Nothing I can do about it. There's actually much more that I could have talked about with respect to viruses and varroa. We've done a large number of experiments over the years, but that's a lot of information. So I picked something that I want to talk about. But of course, I'll be here to talk more later if you have questions, and I can talk about things that I'm not showing today. But I also thought it would be wise to talk a little, or to start with talking about some basic varroa biology, because of course it's a new creature to most of us. So it's actually an old friend or old enemy, depending on where you stand. It was first described in 1904, so it's quite a long time ago. But we didn't really care about the little critter until the early 1980s, when it jumped from Apis serrana, its natural host, to Apis mellifera. There's a whole story behind how that host shift happened, which I'm very happy to gossip about, but I'm not going to say anything publicly. And since 1980s, of course, it's been making its way around the world. So it came into the Netherlands when I was, just before I started my PhD, I was working in a mite lab. And of course, worked in a mite lab, so our lab immediately jumped on the occasion, on the opportunity to study that mite, its biology. So I didn't actively work on varroa myself at the time, but I basically absorbed all this information basically from day one since it arrived in Europe, in the Netherlands. Actually, it started in Germany. So we ignored it because it didn't really have an effect on Apis serrana for reasons I'm going to explain, but of course we now know it does have an effect on Apis mellifera, also for reasons that I'll explain. So the varroa life cycle, I find parasites, I'm a biologist, so I'm a bit strange, I find parasites amazingly interesting because they have this intricate relationship with their host. And of course, varroa is no exception. So all its reproduction finds place in the brood cell. It's completely dependent on bees. It can't live on anything else. And the mites, as we heard earlier, as Andrew explained, has two stages. It has a phoretic phase, where you find the mite mainly on nurse bees, and its reproductive phase, which always happens in the brood. So once a cell is almost ready to be capped, when a nurse cell carrying a mite comes close to the cell to cap it, the female mite will jump off, burrow herself under the larva, and she will then start her reproductive phase. So the cell is capped. She won't come out until the bee comes out with her, happily for her, with her young daughters. So this is the life cycle sketched. So we see mum, she has now, she jumped into cell, she's now locked in. She will immediately start making a feeding hole on the larva or the prepupa. She has to keep that feeding hole open, so she feeds on the hemolymph at this particular stage in her life. She has to keep that feeding hole open because her offspring, when they're tiny little mites, their mouth bars are too weak to make a hole in the bee, so she will have to keep it open for her little babies to feed, so she looks after her babies quite well. The first egg that she lays will always be a boy. She knows exactly what to do, so she produces one son only. This son then patiently waits. He slowly grows up. He grows up faster because he's smaller. And he waits for his sisters. So all the subsequent eggs will be females that will turn into daughters. She will lay eggs at an interval of about 4 to 5 hours. Now, and then this little square, something bizarre happens, which is actually quite normal in the mite world and other little creatures' world, although there's one exception here. So here we have the boy, the son. He has been waiting for his sisters, and now he mates with them on a pile of poop, because these mites, when they poop, basically they stick it on the side of the wall, and apparently that's a great place to mate with your sister. Don't judge me. Don't judge the mites. They can't help it. So we basically have the one boy. His only purpose in life is to wait for his sisters, mates with them, and the males are never found because they die. So when the female, when the bee emerges, she will carry on her all the females to mother if she's not too old, and all the mated females. The boy is never found, he's dead. So because there's no point in having him anymore, he's done his job. So the sex life, as you probably have gathered now, is quite interesting. But genetically, they're also interesting. They're, in a way, they're like bees, because as you know, worker bees can lay eggs that turn into males, because the males are haploid. They only have one set of chromosomes. And this is why a queen has complete control over whether she lays a male egg or a female egg, because if she wants to produce a son, she basically just doesn't put any sperm on the egg and it remains haploid. Same with the mites. So the females are always diploid, two sets of chromosomes, and the males have one set of chromosomes, and they're haploid, and they're tiny. But there's one difference, and this is important with respect to Varroa tolerance, which I'll talk about later. Unlike bees, because as I said earlier, the workers can lay eggs, turn into males, without mating, because worker bees can't mate. But in Varroa, it's different. Oh, and by the way, we call it aeronautiki. It basically means virgin birth. The mites are different, or these mites are different, because the female, even though the males are also haploid, she has to mate in order to be able to produce a son. If the daughters don't mate because the son dies or a son is never produced, all the females will be infertile and they will never be able to reproduce themselves. And that actually may become a trait that one could potentially select on. Oh, I speak too fast. There is what I wanted to say, what I have said. So then the question is, why doesn't Varroa has any negative effects on Sarana? Now, one obvious answer would be no one cared about Sarana because there are no big commercial beekeepers who keep Sarana. Yes, there are some beekeepers in Southeast Asia that do keep Sarana, but maybe we just don't never listen to these people, and there's actually Varroa has the same effect on Sarana as it has on mellifera. Well, that doesn't turn out to be the case, because obviously once Varroa became important to the Western world, people started looking at Sarana and its relationship with Varroa, and it doesn't have a negative effect. So then the question, of course, becomes why? And this is one of the most obvious things that my colleagues in the Netherlands then started to look at. So what is happening in the reproductive cycle with Sarana that prevents Varroa from becoming a problem? So this was the most obvious question at the time. Because Varroa depends on the brood cycle of the bee, the mite lays an egg every 4 to 5 hours. If you shorten the brood cycle, or if the brood cycle is shortened, then of course you reduce the number of female mites that will emerge mated with the emerging bee. So could it be that Sarana just has a much shorter brood cycle and therefore the mite population never builds up because you don't have the same number of mites being produced? Very easy to answer because you basically compare the developmental time of Sarana and mellifera. I'll just highlight the important bits. So yes, Sarana, one day shorter larval stage, one shorter pupal stage for the workers, and one shorter larval stage in drones. That's not a huge difference. But of course, you can imagine that if you lay an egg every 4 to 5 hours, then even 24 hours has a little bit of an effect. But this effect is not big enough. Modeling studies have shown it's not big enough to explain why Sarana doesn't suffer from Varroa. What does turn out to be a key difference is that Varroa doesn't reproduce in worker cells on Apis sarana. Now, that, of course, makes an enormous difference because drones are only produced when virgins are around, maybe once a year. So if the most of the time the Varroa doesn't reproduce, then you never have a huge build-up of mites in your colony, and they can't do any negative effects, whatever that negative thing is that they do. So that is an amazing trait. And of course we don't, well, we do understand why, because, and I should have mentioned that earlier, parasites, as I said, they're really well adapted to their host. Apis arana and Varroa have been together for we don't know how long, maybe millions of years, thousands of years, a very long time. If a parasite kills its host really quickly, or if it just keeps killing its host, then of course it also kills itself because it depends on it and can't spread. So if we always see, if you have an old evolutionary old relationship between a parasite and the host, they tend to become quite benign because they're adapted to each other. So Varroa has evolved to be nice to the bees, or at least so nice that it doesn't negatively affect its own reproduction, its own behavior. And of course, we don't see that yet in mellifera. But one thing that really puzzled a large number of people is that if they would open Serrana brood cells, worker cells, they would still find mites in them, but mostly it was just the female mites and none of her offspring. So if you don't reproduce in the worker cells, why would you jump in? Because you're basically locked up for 20 odd days and you can't do anything else. And then my colleague teamed up with a theoretical biologist because I wanted to see if this was actually a good strategy. If the mortality is high when you stay on your adult bee, could it actually be a means to hide in a brood cell so that you're safe from being nibbled on by bees? And indeed, their studies seem to suggest that this is a really wise strategy if the mortality is high when you stay on the bees. And they had some idea that the bees were actually really good at finding Varroa on adult bees and damaging them, because they started finding all these Varroa mites with chopped off legs and chopped off mouth parts. So as it turns out, Apis arana is really good at grooming of the adult bees. So when they find mites on the bees, they tend to start nibbling on them, and that kills the Varroa. So the Varroa is then better off to hide in the brood cell, in the worker brood cell, if she can't go into a drone cell because there are no drone cells around. And I forgot to mention that, but the other, it may have been on the slide, but I'm not reading my slides when I'm talking. The other thing that Apis arana is good at is if there are multiple females in a brood cell, so two foundresses, as we call them, jumped in at the same time, the nurse bees that check the broods, they will sense that there's multiple mites in those cells, they uncap the cell, take the brood out, and thereby also reduced the number of mites. So that is what now became known as Varroa hygienic behavior, or whatever you call it. So the bees are good at grooming them from the adult bees. They're good at removing them if there are too many in the brood cells. So that's the bee behavior, but then also the Varroa just doesn't reproduce in a worker cell. So these are the traits that we find in Apis arana. Okay. So, but now we have Varroa on Apis mellifera since the 1980s. And what does it actually do? What are the negative effects of having this mite in your bee? We used to think it only drank the hemolymph, so it's basically the bee blood, which of course it does do when it's in the brood cell. But now, since I think it's 2 years ago, an American PhD student, and I always forget his name, his last name is Ramsey, Sam Ramsey, he found that the bees, when they're on adults, they actually feed on the fat body of the bees. And the fat bodies are apparently really important for the immune system of the bees. So the idea is, and I don't think it's been actually proven, his idea is that if you have Varroa feeding on you, and also you have to appreciate these mites, are big for a bee. Maybe in comparison, it would be something that's this big that's sitting on my neck and drinking my blood. So it's not a trivial parasite in that respect. So this group in the US now thinks that one negative effect is that sucking on the fat body suppresses the bee's immune system and makes them more vulnerable to disease. But as I said, I'm not sure. I haven't seen any data that has conclusively shown that that is the case, but it's very plausible, I think. So there could definitely be direct effects of having this parasite feed on you. But the thing that people are most fearful of is the fact that Varroa is a potential vector of honeybee viruses, either because it spreads it more quickly or because it changes the dynamic by selecting for more virulent viruses for a reason I'll explain in a second. So we know there's about 24 known viruses, actually since bee viruses, I should say. And that number is increasing because now people use genomics, and our lab has used genomics too. Emily Remnant, who some of you know or will know soon because she gives a lot of talks to beekeepers. She has sort of spearheaded this search for bee viruses by looking at their genome. So you basically get goo from bees, you send it to a lab, and they give you all the DNA sequences, and then you have someone like Emily who trawls through all the data and finds new viruses. So a few years ago, we found a new virus in that way. So that number, we don't really know, say about 24. What we do know, and this is work that was done in England, 60s and 70s, that most of the bee viruses don't tend to harm the bees. They're there at a very low level. And they can have seasonal outbreaks if the bees are stressed or conditions are bad or whatever, which of course gives stressed bees. But they don't tend to be a serious problem. Most of those are transmitted by prophylaxis, so when the bees are feeding each other. And this, again, is also because of this co-evolutionary arms race between a host and a pathogen. So think about the way viruses are transmitted. And I know this is a disgusting photo, but it does show the whole point. If you are an airborne virus, we know one quite well, COVID-19, then the best thing to do if you're a virus and you want to be spread from person to person, which of course is what you want in an evolutionary sense, it is really good if you keep your host moving around and sneezing like crazy on other susceptible hosts. So if that is the way you need to be transmitted, then you have to be relatively nice to your host. So this host moves around, goes to meetings like this, sits next to someone, sneezes in their face, and then you are transmitted. So this is what the bee viruses used to be like, not via sneezing, but via prophylaxis. Now think about another way in which viruses can be transmitted. Malaria, which is not a virus actually, but parasites. Dengue fevers, already mentioned. They are all transmitted by mosquitoes. So now you have an extremely sick child, probably dying of malaria in this photo. Doesn't matter for malaria in this case, because malaria will have a nice mosquito. In fact, I'm digressing now, but studies have shown that there's a particular life stage of the malaria parasite, which is the life stage that needs to get into a mosquito, that makes the person who's sick extremely attractive to the right mosquitoes. That is how clever these parasites are. Anyway, so the mosquito now comes, bites the little child, and transmits the malaria to the next host. So the virus, the dengue, or malaria, doesn't care if the host is completely sick, can't move around because there's a vector. So this selects for more virulent strains, or it selects for a particular different virus, but we're pathogen. But when we're talking about bee viruses, the idea was now that Varroa would select for more virulent strains of viruses that are normally not very virulent. So this is the basic idea. You have a beautiful virus host system, now you introduce a vector and everything goes wrong. So normally, the virus depends on the bees moving around to be transmitted. All fine, the bees are happy, the virus is happy, they just bubble along in the colony. But that all changes when you introduce a vector, because now the virus thinks, hey, hang on, I don't have to be nice anymore. And then you get competition between different strains. The ones that replicate so fast will normally be selected against because they will kill the bee before they can be spread. But now Varroa does the dirty work for them and you get more virulent strains. So this is very basic epidemiology theory, and that seemed to perfectly fit Varroa and defoam-winged virus when Varroa arrived on the islands of Hawaii. And this is actually done by a former colleague of mine, Steve Martin. We worked together in the UK when I lived there. So they've been following the spread of Varroa across the islands of Hawaii, islands where there was no Varroa yet, waiting for Varroa to arrive, etc., and then keep sampling again as Varroa moved its way across. And they were particularly interested in the viral landscape of those colonies. And as the title suggests, what they found was a massive shift in the viral landscape as Varroa moved across the islands of Hawaii. One virus in particular stood out, and that was deformed wing virus. So initially, when there was no Varroa, there was a huge variety of deformed wing virus strains. As Varroa had moved across, there was only one prevalent strain of deformed wing virus remaining. All the other ones were selected against, or they had disappeared. Same story close to home in New Zealand by Fanny Monday and Alison Mercer. They found the exact same thing. The viral landscape changed, lots of viruses disappeared, or they briefly had a surgence and then they disappeared, and the virus that was seen everywhere after the arrival of Varroa was deformed wing virus again. Now, what is deformed wing virus? It is an RNA virus, just like COVID, and it's now almost always mentioned in one breath with Varroa, or one sentence with Varroa. It's named after the supposedly negative effect it has on bees, the crumpled wings, the deformed wings. But of course, if you've ever had stressed bees because they were too cold or too warm as brood, they always get crumpled wings when they're stressed. So it's not a specific symptom of deformed wing virus. And deformed wing virus is actually an insect virus. So there's a lot of papers now, especially from Europe, where they talk about spillover. So if you have an apiary which is highly infected with deformed wing virus, if you start then sampling all insects around that apiary, you will find deformed wing virus in them, because it's a generic insect virus. So it's not specific to bees, it's just called deformed wing virus because it was first described in bees. Now this unfortunately is outdated, because you can see Australia is still seen as the one and only country without Varroa. So this is the global distribution of Varroa, not up to date as you can see, and you can overlay this with the abundance or prevalence or whatever you want to call it of deformed wing virus. Identical patterns. So, newsflash, is it deformed wing virus that's actually killing the bees and Varroa is sort of an innocent bystander? Is it the real evil? So this is where Emily and I came in a few years ago, thinking we have the unique opportunity now to study deformed wing virus bees and Varroa in isolation, because we don't have Varroa. At the time, it was actually quite funny, we applied for a grant from what was then called RUDIC, the honeybee part of the rural development, I can't remember what they're called, they're now AgriFutures, in which we wanted to investigate the option or the possibility that Wolbachia, which is an internal parasite of insects that is known to convey resistance to RNA viruses, particularly dengue fever. It's actually now introduced in far north Queensland, where I now live, as a means to reduce the negative effect of dengue fever. If we could use Wolbachia as a method to prevent deformed wing virus killing our bees. But we were so naive that we hadn't really realized that deformed wing virus is absent from Australia. So we never got the permission to do it because we couldn't do it because there was no deformed wing virus. Anyway, that's still something that I think people should look at. However, so a few years later, we did get permission to work on deformed wing virus because the problem became more important, we thought, to look at. So we did work on deformed wing virus in Australia in the lab, and I know I had to write some papers for beekeeper journals because we got phone calls, the lab got phone calls from concerned beekeepers. We hear that you're doing evil things in your lab. And well, we're not doing evil things. We have the permit, we have the setup, we can work with deformed wing virus. So we were allowed to inject pupae with deformed wing virus, but we were never allowed to work with flying bees. And this, again, will become important later on. So as soon as the pupae emerged, so we could score them whether they were alive or not, but then we immediately had to kill the bees. We tried to apply, we tried to find ways of having a safe, a biosecure, safe flying cages, etc., but the university was very unwilling to put the money in. So keep that caveat in mind, I'll come back to that later. We only know what deformed wing virus does or doesn't do on pupae. So because this is the question we wanted to ask. We wanted to know, how bad is deformed wing virus if you don't have a vector? What is likely going to be happening once Varroa gets in if you have deformed wing virus in your bees? So we were pretending to be Varroa with a syringe. Again, so this is a very typical virology experiment. We call it a serial transmission experiment. So the idea is you inject your virus into one individual or a few individuals. You wait until the virus starts replicating. Then you mush it up, you extract a hemolymph, and you inject that straight into the next generation. So this, you're basically pretending to be a vector going from B to B, regardless of the negative effect of the virus on the host. So we did that for 30 cycles. We had four colonies, but two colonies for bee reasons that didn't quite work. Sorry, I shouldn't say colonies. We got the pupae from colonies because this is all done in the lab. We must have had five colonies, otherwise I wouldn't be showing you four and five, but it's been a while ago, so I can't quite remember the details. So, okay, so these are the results, or the results will come. So on the y-axis, we have the amount of virus that we measured, and then we have the colonies, and the 1, 10, 20, 30 refers to the transmission cycle, so how often we transmitted the hemolymph. Deformed wing virus, that's the source. As you can see, there's two strains, because at the time, deformed wing virus A and B were famous, and I can talk about them more offline too later. So we mainly had deformed wing virus A in that sample, which came from collaborators in New Zealand. And we had a control. So these are just a pupae. As you know, pupae are quite vulnerable, so we had to have a control for just the manipulation, getting them out of the comb and putting them in petri dishes, etc. Then the B is a very important control in these kinds of experiments. That's a buffer injection. So you inject the bees with only with the buffer in which you have the virus dissolved, because what those people in England in the 60s also found is that you can just traumatize the bees a little bit by just sticking a needle in them, and that can often sort of awaken viruses that are there but don't normally show any negative effects. And then we have our transmission cycles. And this is the surprising result. We thought it was surprising, given that deformed wing virus is so infamous. Deformed wing virus just disappeared from our samples. And what we found instead is sacbrood virus and black queen cell virus. They just completely took over. Now, this puzzled us for a long time, but we also wanted to know what the negative effects on the bees themselves were. And this is one of those occasions where you scratch your head for a long time. We had discussions, but how can you measure whether a pupa is dead or alive? It seems so simple, but they don't move. They don't do anything. Then I was on the phone with someone, and I think he was one of the administrators who used to work at CSIRO in the insect department, and he was calling me about something completely different, but he was always interested in this virus stuff that we were doing. So he asked me, how are you going? I said, it's sort of going all right, but we want to know if our pupae are dead or alive, and I can't figure out how because we can't measure it. And he said, yeah, you can. Well, how can we measure it? Said, look at their eyes. Because if they don't develop anymore, they're dead, and their eyes stay the same color. So we thought, oh, that is simple. So we had a lovely honor student, Thomas Gillard, who actually wants to be a professional beekeeper. And he worked on this. He designed this very cute, I think, but unbiased protocol. So this is what we call a 96 well plate, which is what you use in a molecular lab. You just pipette things in it, but now you put it on its side and you put the pupae in just as if they were sitting in a comb. Now, they have funny colors, which is because for the different treatments, we had a little bit of food dye in with the injection so we could check whether the injection actually worked. So they're labeled. Well, these are Tom's labels. And then every day he would take photos of every single pupa and then later put the serum together of every pupa and just watched when the eyes stopped changing color. So this is an example, the top of the control pupa. And as you can see, the eyes just happily get darker and darker. That pupa is alive, and in the end it emerged. At the bottom, though, is an injected pupa, and from day two, there was no change in the color anymore, so this pupa died at the age two. Day two. So very simple, and it's one of those funny conversations that we often seem to have where you find a solution to something you've been scratching your head about for a long time. But what did we find? So this is a very standard way of plotting survival data. So at the top we have the control. So these are the ones we didn't do anything with, zero mortality. We had one pupa die after injection with the buffer. And to our surprise, we only had two bees, I think, die when they only had deformed wing virus in them, nothing else. But it was very different. Oh yeah, so I should explain. So all the dead pupa we collected later on, analyzed them to see which viruses they carried. So that's why we could discriminate between the ones that died that only had deformed wing virus in them and the ones that died that also had sacbrood virus and black queen cell virus in them, because they always had both. It's never one or the other. But sometimes they didn't have any deformed wing virus in them anymore, even though they were injected with it. And then that's the green line. And then have deformed wing virus, sacbrood virus, and black queen cell virus, and that's the orange line. Now, statistically, there's no difference between the green and the orange line, which means that the addition of deformed wing virus to that mix did not affect mortality. There's no statistical difference between the red line and the buffer line either. So having deformed wing virus did not kill the pupa. So that's the conclusion. This data set metaphorically laid in my office drawer for a long time because nothing ever is in a drawer anymore. It's all on the computer, because I couldn't make any sense out of this at all. But what the point is, we now came to realize, is that deformed wing virus is a very bad competitor. It's a relatively benign virus in the sense that it can't compete with all the other viruses, particularly black queen cell virus and sacbrood virus. So in the presence of the other viruses, you just don't see it, because it can't compete. And this will explain the ubiquitous association between Varroa and deformed wing bars. We've done many other studies, as I said in the beginning, I had to pick and choose what I was going to talk about, but they all confirmed that deformed wing bars doesn't kill the brute. With the caveat, we were never allowed to study its effect on the adult bees. And when we did find death, it was probably due to black queen cell virus, because a later study, we didn't have separate virus, just by sheer chance in our sample, bee sample. And every time we had black queen cell virus, those pupae died, because it's a very virulent virus, and that kills them very quickly. So then the question is deformed wing virus not the evil, bad, and horrible virus, and we should stop being scared about it? Well, it is complicated, and that's one reason why people hate scientists, because they never give you a clear answer. They will always say it is complicated. But a complication in this case is really because we can't study the effect on the adult bees. We do know it doesn't kill larvae and it doesn't kill pupae, unlike black queen cell virus, sacbrood virus, Kashmir bee virus, and you name a whole range of nasties. And this means that after Varroa comes in, starts acting as a vector, all the nasties die, and deformed wing virus is the last virus standing. And therefore, you see the two go together. So what do we think happens? Oh, this should have come up, I didn't check the animation. In the absence of Varroa or any other vector, we see that the viruses are there at very low levels. Everyone's happy, the bees are happy, the viruses are happy. Varroa comes in and you get this massive change in the transmission cycle. Now the nasties briefly take over and you see this in a huge colony death. If you look carefully at Fanny Mondet's paper, so she looked at the Varroa moving across New Zealand, which is a very dense paper. This is actually all in her paper because she meticulously documented the changes in all the viruses, not just deformed wing virus, all of them. If you dig deep, you see this pattern. She explains this, or she already hypothesizes this. So the bees and the mites now die. Because if the virus kills the brute, the mites die too because they have no food. They basically die with the brute. So the nasty viruses also die, and Varroa is the only, deformed wing virus is now the only one that is there. So that is my story, deformed wing virus. Keeping in mind, as I said, we don't know what it does on adult bees. Which brings me to the last bit, Varroa resistance or tolerance. We started in Europe, we started talking about resistance first, but normally resistance really means that you don't have any mites in this case in your colony. You're completely resistant to the parasite, which is not the case. So we're talking about, it's more accurate to talk about Varroa tolerance, where you tolerate a large mites without having a negative effect. And that, of course, is the situation we see in Apis serrana. So ever since Varroa arrived in Europe, beekeepers, particularly hobby beekeepers, actually have been starting to select for Varroa tolerance. So they're basically, of course, they're in Europe, so they have a serious winter, which means they can, in spring, they basically select the strongest colonies without treatment, and they start breeding from those colonies. They discard the ones, well, they probably discard themselves because they die over winter, and that's the way they select for Varroa tolerance. Nothing fancy, they haven't been selecting for any particular trait, and the same is true for some researchers that I'll talk about in a second. They've never selected for a particular trait. They basically wanted to know, if we don't do anything other than selecting the strongest colonies, will we get into the situation as we have with Apis serrana? So that's basically their scheme. Don't treat them, select the strongest colonies, make sure you have controlled mating, no artificial insemination involved either. So my colleagues in Wageningen in the Netherlands, they have been doing this. They started in 2007 with one population and 2009 with the other population, and the details can be found in this paper. And so they followed this recipe, But then in 2017, when they had the two established colony populations, they wanted to find out, well, what makes these colonies varroa tolerant? And the first question they asked is it this varroa sensitive hygiene? So what Delphine, she was a PhD student at the time, what she did is she took combs and she collected mites and she added bees, mites to brood cells, marked the brood cells and basically tried to see if the bees would remove the cells in which she introduced mites, irrespective of whether there were already mites in the brood cell or not. Now, to her surprise, not to her surprise, one of the population did show this varroa-sensitive hygienic behaviour. So there was the mechanism that that population used to keep the mite numbers down, but the other population didn't. There was no difference in varroa-sensitive hygiene behaviour or the percentage of uncapped cells in that population and the control population. Interestingly, in that population, it seems that the mites do enter worker cells, but they don't reproduce. It could either be that they don't reproduce at all, so she doesn't even try to reproduce, or that the boys die, which is another way of suppressing the mite population. If the boys die for some reason, as I said, then the girls can't mate, and then the population goes down. So they don't quite understand what's going on there, but they do know that mite reproduction is lower in that second colony. Population. And then those both populations and mite numbers are similar to colonies treated with oxalic acid because they don't use anything else. Now, in the meantime, upstate New York, which of course is a completely different climate to Australia, I've been there, tried to work with bees, and it was still snowing in May, which I was not impressed by. Working with swarming honeybees then in the snow doesn't work. But Tom Seeley, since he grew up in upstate New York, he's always worked in upstate New York, he's obsessed with the bees upstate New York. So when after he retired, he wanted to try and find out what's happening to the wild colonies, actually feral colonies in the woods, which ones will survive varroa without being treated. So he wrote a book about this, following the wild bees. And what he found key is the colonies that swarm every year are the ones that survive or are tolerant, which I think is a little bit circular because, so he claims it's because they have this broodless period, as Andrew explained earlier, you have to have this broodless period if you want to treat your mites. So if you don't have brood because you're swarming, then the mites can't reproduce. But of course, only colonies, wild colonies that are strong enough will swarm every year. So what came first? I'm not quite sure. But Tom is going around in the US and telling people that they should not treat against varroa because he is a strong believer in the power of the bees doing it themselves. I worked with Tom, and if I asked him a question and he wouldn't know the answer, he would say, let's go and ask the bees. So he's a lovely man to work with. I've learned a lot from, we call him the guru, the bee guru. I've also done a lot of work in South Africa with my dear colleague, Mike Alsop. So Mike actually did his master's thesis on varroa, and varroa came into South Africa. You may or may not know there's two subspecies of Apis mellifera in South Africa, the Cape honeybee, which is famous, and the African bee, Apis mellifera scutellata, which is very famous because that's the source of the Africanized bees. So Mike's been following, or had been following, the arrival of varroa again and the arrival, if you wish, of varroa tolerance. It took 3 to 5 years in the Cape honeybee and 6 to 7 years in mellifera capensis. And they're not even allowed to use any miticides. My understanding is from Mike that it's banned. They can't legally buy any miticides in South Africa. And the bees are doing well. I mean, Apis mellifera scutellata is a completely different beast altogether. Very interesting. Can be very scary. So what are the tolerance mechanisms that we know so far? Hygienic behavior, both the varroa-sensitive hygienic behavior, grooming, Apis mellifera, Zencerana, taking the mites off the adult bees, suppression of mite reproduction, It's something that people mention, but it's one of those catchwords. Well, we mention it, but we don't really know how it works at all. We just know that the mites go into brood cells, but don't reproduce. And frequent swarming, or anything that gives you a break in the brood cycle. So the question is, are we evolving towards a less destructive relationship? I think if you would take, if no one would manipulate their bees at all, mellifera, then of course we would, or either the bees would die out. But that's not an answer, especially not for professional beekeepers. I am with Tom Seeley in the sense that natural selection is an extremely powerful force, but we're talking about whole industries that can't just say, well, we're not going to do anything, let the bees sort it out, because I am convinced that the bees will sort it out. But it's going to take a while, it's going to take a lot of beekeepers going broke. But what I do find hopeful and interesting is that the mechanisms we now find in Apis mellifera are the same mechanisms that we find in Apis cerana. So that there definitely seems to be a pattern. Oh, yes. So we have different tolerance mechanisms, and I think that's important to keep in mind too. There's not one size fits all. Different populations will do different things because there's just the Varroa mite will select on one particular trait that population just seems to have. Other population will find a different solution to the same problem. And this is what people have called the Darwinian approach. So you basically let the bees decide what it is that they want to focus on with trying to deal with this new parasite, which I think is the best way possible, because I know lots of people are thinking about, well, introducing semen from Varroa-sensitive populations from overseas, which has the very serious potential of introducing deforming virus. Because, yes, I'm saying we don't find evidence that it's a bad and nasty, evil thing that people claim to have. But if we can just not have it here, that would probably be much safer bet, so don't do that. But my biggest objection is that what we really need, and I am biased because I'm an evolutionary biologist, so as I said, I believe in the power of natural selection, is that selection will only be possible if you have Varroa here, because we're looking for specific behaviors of the bees in response to a parasite. And that doesn't mean that if you get a behavior that works in upstate New York or California or in Germany, that you can just take that and get the queen, if you were allowed to get that queen from that selected population, put her in here in the Australian conditions, which of course we know are completely diverse anyway, and then it will work and it will all solve the problem. I just don't believe that that's the way to go. I think everyone has to look at their own bees and select for particular traits in their own bees because they're locally adapted, and that, to my mind, is the only way forward if you don't want to use any miticides. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you.